Myth number two. Climate change is normal. The climate has changed before, and heat waves have happened before, right?
Even some of the negotiators know they are not doing nearly enough.
You had situations where the presenter of the show had been sort of not informed enough on the topic and hadn't challenged some of the climate skeptic guests.
What kind of reaction has it generated?
Well, the story that I wrote for Carbon Brief, we obtained the four-page, what they call a crib sheet, which is effectively guidelines on how to report climate change, and also revealed that they were going to be sort of offering one-hour training courses to journalists.
For those who don't know about us, we are a global think tank that was established some 50 years ago.
What do we want? Climate justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
We are effectively trying to cause enough disruption to force attention onto the basic truth of our predicament. We need rapid, far-reaching and unprecedented changes to every aspect of our society. And nothing like that is happening.
The government's not really listening to our pleas against climate change.
We have not come here to beg world leaders to care.
What do we want? Climate justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Siffror från Lunds universitet visar att barn har en betydligt högre påverkan på klimatet om man jämför både med kost, flyg och bil.
Enough of indifference and inaction. The decades of apathy and procrastination must end here in Katowice.
As journalists, we're all consumed right now with the need for greater transparency to explain our work to a cynical public. Does this help or hurt that effort, in your view?
When it comes to deniers, I claim they're a problem. And we have to work that problem. We have to address climate change deniers in the same way we have to build wind turbines, we have to build new, better battery systems. We have to work all those problems at once, and deniers are one of the problems.
Och vi tycker ju att vi ska diskutera skatt. För så jobbar vi ju med andra miljöfrågor. Man lägger skatt på det som man inte vill ha, på det som är miljöfarligt, och sen använder man de pengarna till en omställning och istället gynna saker som är bra.
Jag tror att väljarna ändå har en förståelse för att vi som litet parti i minoritetsregering inte har kunnat genomföra precis allting som vi talade om i valrörelsen.
Kan du tolka det som att väljarna har förståelse? Ni ligger på 3,6%. Det verkar som att de inte alls har någon förståelse.
I'm a researcher and I basically research rebellions. The emailing, writing letters, going on a day march, it's no good. You need about 400 people to go to prison. Maybe you need 2,000 or 3,000 people to get arrested. And I'm at the position where I'm going to go down in November because I'm ready, because we've got nothing else to lose. Can everyone fill in one of these, even if you're only vaguely interested? Oh.
Go to prison for a short time. One. Two. 6, 13, 14 people, all-time record. The action itself not actually that important. It's the going to prison, which is, has got cultural resonance, as you might say.
Till stor del på grund av att de nödvändiga reformerna är olagliga, äganderätten för starkt skyddad och politiken egentligen oförmögen till annat än att administrera det nuvarande ekonomiska systemet. När allt kommer omkring är resultatet från Tyskland vad vi själva konkret lyckades åstadkomma på plats. Och detta är ingenting att fnysa åt, för det betyder något. Vi vet idag att vi har någonstans mellan 10-15 år att arbeta med. Antingen har vi vunnit innan tidsfristen löper ut, eller så går vi över tröskeln till där planeten accelererar sig själv till 6 graders uppvärmning. Och civilisationen står inte längre kvar på en 6 grader varmare planet.
I'm far more afraid of climate change than I am of arrest or imprisonment.
I'm willing to go to prison for this planet, and I'm willing to go again and again and again until I see some results, until we all see a better world.
The government is refusing to do anything.
Och jag tänker så här att många av er det här, man tänker så här, men vilken absurd jämförelse. Man kan väl inte jämföra flygresor med barn. Men det kan man, för jag säger välkommen till Efter 50 Gurgen som har planerat att sterilisera sig.
Tack.
För att inte belasta klimatet med ett barn.
Ja, så det är ju, jag menar, varje människa är ju resursslitage och vi kan ju källsortera och plastband till allt det där, det är jättebra liksom.
Aha.
Vi kan göra så mycket som vi kan, men det här är ju liksom, vi måste fokusera, tror jag, på de största och förändra dem. Till exempel, vi kan bli veganer, vi kan sluta flyga, men det här om att sluta, forskarna säger ju skaffa färre barn.
Ja.
Och det mest optimala, jag tror att de måste bli lite mer radikala och säga, skaffa inte barn.
Vi kan... Men det går ju inte, för då överlever ju inte mänskligheten om ingen skaffar barn.
Ja, fast människan är ju inte kronan på verket. Alltså, vi tillhör ju ett system. Vi har separerat oss så mycket från system, djur och natur.
Ja.
Och det är det vi måste gå tillbaka till och tänka mer cirkulärt och kanske uppmuntra hela omställningsrörelsen till att normalisera så här. Och liksom att välja att leva barnfritt.
Men...
All of the things that capitalism does, though, comes at the cost of the rest of the world.
No, that's the problem. No, that's why you're wrong, because people's lives have been improved.
I'm not talking about humans.
This equation has four factors, a little bit of multiplication. So you've got a thing on the left, CO2, that you want to get to zero. And that's going to be based on the number of people, the services each person's using on average, the energy on average for each service, and the CO2 being put out per unit of energy. So let's look at each one of these and see how we can get this down to zero. Probably one of these numbers is going to have to get pretty near to zero. That's back from high school algebra. But let's take a look. First, we've got population. The world today has 6.8 billion people. That's headed up to about 9 billion. Now, if we do a really great job on new vaccines, healthcare, reproductive health services, we could lower that by perhaps 10 or 15%.
I'm not talking about humans.
Okay, well, frankly, I think that we should preserve resources, but at the end of the day, the environment is there so that humans can be happy and have a higher quality of life.
That's awesome. I'm sorry. So selfish.
It's not really selfish. Yeah. I think it's selfish to put birds over human beings. It's selfish to want to decrease people's standards of living so that there are people who are bees.
I'm not decreasing it.
Ja, men vi tycker ju i Feministiskt initiativ att vi ska använda skattemedlet. Vi ska lägga på skatt. Vi har ju pratat om i vår ekonomiska politik att lägga på 10 kronor per konsumerat kilo. Sen får man ju utreda hur det ska fördelas mellan olika sorters kött. För att det är ju olika om man tittar på nötkött, om man tittar på lammkött eller kyckling eller så. Så att det där får man ju differentiera. Men vi måste använda det verktyget för att få fler människor att ställa om kosthållningen.
Now, they were given a task, I guess, as I said before, of coming up with an idea to unite the planet, you see. And it looked at everything under the sun, like even aliens from outer space attack, you know, from anything at all, make us all have to give up national sovereignty and come into global governance to save us all. It's always to save us all, you see. It's got to be done that way to get all the rights taken away from you. And this is with the disappearance of the traditional enemy, the temptation is to use religious or ethnic minorities as scapegoats, especially those whose differences from the majority are disturbing. Every state has been so used to classifying its neighbors as friend or foe that the sudden absence of traditional adversaries has left governments and public opinion with a great void to fill. New enemies have to be identified, new strategies imagined, and absence of traditional adversaries and new weapons devised, I should say, in searching for a common enemy. So this is what they came up with. 1972, and searching for a common enemy against whom we can unite. And actually, this is from 72, but actually we put it out in a more definite format, 91, it says. But it says, in searching for a common enemy against whom we can unite, we came up with the idea that pollution, the threat of global warming, water shortages, famine and the like, would fit the bill. We would fit the bill to get to totalitarian governments. In their totality and their interactions, these phenomena do constitute a common threat which must be confronted by everyone together. But in designating these dangers as the enemy, we fall into the trap which we have already warned readers about, namely mistaking symptoms for causes. All these dangers are caused by human intervention in natural processes, and it's only through changed attitudes and behavior that they can be overcome. The real enemy, then, is humanity itself. You see, that's what it's all about. But not their humanity, your humanity, you see. In fact, this group might not even call you human.
And the background really is that it's now almost 50 years that the Club of Rome, through the report Limits to Growth, alerted the world to the environmental and demographic challenges ahead. And the central message of that report, Limits to Growth, was that the quest for unlimited growth in both population and demand for material resources would, on a finite planet, of course, would eventually lead to increasing problems and most probably a collapse of both the economic and environmental system.
Du tror du att gensvaret för den typen av förslag ser ut i det politiska landskapet som ni...
Ja, vad jag förstår hittills är det ju väldigt få partier som vågar sig på det här. Men om vi tittar på fakta och forskning så är ju de på vår sida. Myndigheter som jobbar med frågorna är ju på vår sida. Så att det kommer ju att komma, men det krävs ett opinionsarbete.
Why can the mayor of New York call himself a warrior against climate change if he uses a helicopter to get around a city? When he could take public transportation?
Oh, you know, we get those kinds of questions all the time. And I can't speak for the mayor of New York, of course. But no, I think it is a very fair question. I think that we're trying to change an entire system here.
When it comes to deniers, I claim they're a problem.
He's upped the ante. He's now saying that we should all die in order to advance the global warming agenda. And I love the way he says, I can guarantee you that they will die. Well, he's guaranteeing that everyone's going to die at some point. So that's the science of Bill Nye. But this is very in line with the whole debate of intimidation and silence. And Bill Nye is the leader of that now, unfortunately, and he's got a big influence with young minds. And that's why he's so confident he can convert the young people to climate action. But he's having trouble with anyone his age and older because, frankly, they're wiser and they've experienced a lot. So they're less susceptible to his propaganda.
So no room for debate. It kind of shows how science can be a religion, you know, kill the heretics.
Så hur ser vi på politisk praktik mot en bakgrund som detta? Vårt förslag är att på allvar börja med sabotage. Normalisera den direkta aktionen mot klimatskadlig infrastruktur. Låt den förstörda järnvägen där kolet tidigare transporterades till de svenska stålverken vara det politiska budskapet. Och låt sedan den förstörda järnvägen vara resultatet i sin egen rätt när politikerna misslyckas med att leva upp till våra krav. Skär däcken på en Range Rover. Sabotera maskinerna som bygger ut Primref. Sprid sabotaget i det stora och i det lilla och försvara dess legitimitet. När allt kommer omkring är det vi kan räkna med vad vi själva konkret kan åstadkomma. Ni som inte själva vill eller känner att ni kan, se till att stöd de som vill och kan. Moraliskt, politiskt och ekonomiskt. Släpp aktionskonsensus och låt grupper och nätverk löpa linan ut. Om den politiska debatten kretsar kring folk som går eller inte går för långt, kring en fråga där de flesta delar de grundläggande premisserna, då befinner vi oss precis där vi vill vara. Men om detta fortfarande inte översätts till radikal politik kan vi, när allt kommer omkring, fortfarande räkna med vad vi konkret kan åstadkomma. Förstör vad som förstör klimatet. Och vänta inte på att politikerna ska göra det åt oss. Tack.
Ja, den kör. Det är min mans bil och han är skulptör och han jobbar med sten.
Låt det till Kap Verde har jag läst.
Gud vad folk är intresserade av den semestern.
Precis, men det är ju lite intressant för att du var där på semester och du fick en fråga om det. Och då sa du att de här problemen inte handlar om ditt liv utan om ett stort ekonomiskt system som mäktiga och rika män bestämmer över. Vad menar du med det då?
Jo, jag menar att det är helt tillåtet att idag tjäna hur mycket pengar som helst på att helt obeskattat ha flygbolag och sälja olja. Medan våra val som individer kan påverka en viss del. Om vi inte börjar beskatta det här på samhällsnivå tror jag inte vi kommer någon vart.
Ska du inte leva som du lär?
Jag försöker visa att man får vara engagerad även om man inte lever ett perfekt liv. Det är väldigt svårt. Min generations liv kommer präglas i väldigt hög utsträckning av stora naturkatastrofer och stora flyktingströmmar på grund av konflikter skapade av klimatförändringar. Det kommer vara en troligtvis ganska kaotisk tid jag kommer få växa upp i. Och jag tycker inte det är rättvist att dagens vuxna får släppa ut hur mycket de vill utan att betala skatt för det. Och jag undrar, vad ger din generation rätt att flyga hur mycket ni vill högre än min generations rätt att leva på en säker planet? Men tror du på riktigt att det går att driva innovation om man fortsätter subventionera flyg oavsett bränsle? Om man fortsätter ha flyget helt skattebefriat? Enda anledningen till att innovation uppstår är ju att man äntligen börjar beskatta det som skadar. Att skylla på teknikaliteter för att inte vilja ta ansvar för klimatet, det tycker jag är extremt fett. Och jag tror du vet att det här inte stämmer. Exakt, beskattar det då?
Men inte med en skatt.
Beskattar det då? Nej, det är inte vi som straffar resenärerna. Det är resenärerna som straffar min generation. Beskattar det då? Nej, beskattar det då? Nej.
Vart ska du flyga i sommar?
Till Portugal.
Du ska det? Ja, så där.
Dr. Moore, what are the issues coming up for India at the climate change talks?
Well, India is a very large country with 300 million people with no electricity, and the Prime Minister wants to build the power plants, coal and nuclear, to provide them with electricity, and the coal plants produce carbon dioxide emissions. So everybody wants India to stop, at least all the people who are alarmist about the climate change. I personally do not believe in this issue. I think it is very much a fabrication. We have no proof that human emissions of carbon dioxide are causing the warming of the earth, which began 300 years ago at the end of the Little Ice Age.
So is all this climate change alarm a hoax?
It's not so much a hoax as it is a fabrication, which I guess you could say the same thing, but it is a powerful convergence of interests among key elites in our society, the politicians, the media, the green movement, the green business who wants to get subsidies to build infrastructure which would never be built under the normal economic situation. And the scientists and science institutions who are bringing in billions of dollars for this research. What is this research producing which is of value? Is it producing new products that are beneficial to the public? Is it producing electricity? Is it producing anything? No, only fear. That's the only thing all of this so-called climate science is producing, is fear in the public so that they are more easily manipulable by the Greens and the politicians and the media, etc. So I simply do not believe that we should be listening to them. I believe we should recognize that carbon dioxide is the most important food for all life on Earth. It's what plants eat to make sugars, which is the basis of energy for all life. And all life is carbon-based on this Earth. Carbon is the building block of life. And without carbon in the atmosphere, this would be a dead planet. So surely that counts for something. The fact that life would be impossible without carbon dioxide means that at least it has some good to it. And as a matter of fact, I say it's not only essential and beneficial, but it is the most essential and beneficial molecule in the air.
Is the Indian Prime Minister right to push ahead with coal as one source of energy despite all that the alarmists say?
Yes, I think it's okay to have a balanced portfolio of electricity production. India does not have a huge amount of natural gas, but does have a lot of coal, could have a lot more hydroelectric power. I think that's the one thing that's missing in India's chance, is to use the water coming from Himalayas into hydroelectric dams, which would then provide irrigation for the farmers in the middle of the country who are pumping water with diesel engines now, and would also control the water so they could irrigate a far larger area of land and increase food production.
And few still doubt the impact of human influence
over this predicted catastrophe.
Those activities which are emitting carbon dioxide are obviously imposing a cost on the earth, on humanity, on this generation and the next generation.
The number of environmental refugees to more than 250 million people. The shortage of resources and the high number of refugees will increase tensions all over the world.
Or taking your next holiday by train instead of flying.
Or buying energy-saving light bulbs.
We're thinking of using our car less. I'm going to cycle to school.
That's fantastic, Jemima. Now, no pressure at all, but it'd be great to get a sense of how many of you might do this. Just a rough percentage. That's fantastic! And there's Nora. Philip and Tracy. That's fine, that's absolutely fine. Your own choice. Okay, class, thank you so much for today, and I will see you all tomorrow. Oh! Just before you go, I just need to press this little button here. Now, everybody, please remember to read chapters 5 and 6 on volcanoes and glaciation. Except for Philip and Tracy, of course.
Habe ich denn vergessen gehabt?
I remember that the questions at school became more probing. So they wanted to see what programs we were watching at home. During the early years, they imprisoned people when they watched television from the West. Our antenna was always pointed towards the West. The teacher tried to find out if people were watching television from the West.
They wanted to see whether the kids were getting their doses of propaganda and indoctrination at home. Also, they wanted to see whether the kids would rat out their parents and are you taking in Western propaganda? Are you taking in information from outside of the approved sources or not? It reminds me of the way that kids were asked to report on how their parents used water in their home, whether they recycled in their home.
Dricker dina föräldrar mycket kaffe? Visste du att när man producerar bönorna till en kopp kaffe så krävs det 140 liter vatten? Kanske kan du tipsa dina föräldrar att dricka mindre kaffe.
Singers like Frank Schirbel, dubbed East Germany's Cliff Richard, were sometimes told by the party what to sing. Frank's co-star and then wife, Chris Dirk, misses much about East Germany.
Art and culture had a much higher value placed on them.
Chris Dirk enjoyed socialist life behind the wall.
Ja, und ich habe wirklich nicht schlecht gelebt. Also ich.
I didn't lead a bad life, and I have to say that the Berlin Wall didn't really disturb me.
All I wanted was to have a bit of fun, but the state obviously saw it differently. We were criminalized. We were politicized.
Chaos was the lead singer in a punk rock band called Wutenfall, meaning fit of rage. His best friend Zappa was the bass guitarist. What Chaos didn't know was that his best friend was a Stasi informer.
I didn't expect it to be so drastic for me. By the end, there were 9 informers set on me.
Chaos only found out about his best friend's treachery after the wall came down, when he read his Stasi file.
I want to talk a little bit about how that woman says she liked it. Look how bitter she was that East Germany is capitalist now. She had a good thing going. And basically, translation of what she said, she had a good thing going and giving freedom to everyone just wrecked it. She says, she kind of cloaks what she means by saying, oh, they put a higher value on art and culture back then, which they don't do now. But then the very next clip we show you is of a guy whose art was suppressed by the state. They went to quite a lot of effort to stop that guy from expressing his art, didn't they? And a part I cut out, the guy at the very beginning that they said was like the Cliff Richard, I think they said, of East Germany. That was her husband. And yet he got put in jail for 3 days and demoted from at work because he wouldn't sing one of the songs they asked him to sing. So they actually demoted him at work and put him in jail. He married this woman And this woman, all this woman can think about is I used to be a pop star before the wall fell. So, I don't know, in watching these documentaries, something that struck me over and over was that the people who liked communism and still like it, still miss it, they seem like very selfish people. I'm just saying.
Och jag har ju då efterlyst att politiker, ämbetsmän, forskare som jobbar med de här frågorna, klimatfrågorna, de ska ju givetvis föregå med gott exempel och visa vad man kan göra för att minska sitt carbon footprint och inte bara kräva det här utav vanligt folk utan även dra konsekvenser i sin egen verksamhet. Och jag kan inte tolka det här 50 miljonerna som man anslår till att göra det lättare att åka nattåg annat än att våra politiker som reser skytteltrafik fram och tillbaka till Bryssel har för avsikt att åka nattåg ner och nattåg hem ifrån Bryssel för att föregå med gott exempel och få oss vanliga människor när vi reser att ta efter dem. Gör de inte det, då är ju det ett väldigt starkt bevis för att de egentligen inte alls tror på det här. Utan det här med klimatet, det är bara ett påhitt för att kunna öka skattebelastningen på oss vanliga människor.
Fru talman, fru talman. Ja, herr talkvinna. Thank you.